Morning guys, it's Carl from Studio In Car, and we're going to cover the Hegel H190 today. Paradoxically, it is about 8 degrees in here today. I can't run the heater during the winter when I'm doing videos because it makes a racket. It doesn't make a racket, it's actually quite quiet in the room, but the mic picks it up like crazy and it just spoils the videos. So yeah, I'm going to get into the guts of the 190. We'll discuss the ins and outs first in comparison to the 390. If you want the comparison to the 590, then watch that video and so on. So it's been 4 months since the 390 review. There's been multiple videos in between because we have to diversify the videos that we do. We can't just, you know, we're not a Hegel business, we're a hi-fi and car audio business, so yeah, we have to break them up. So yeah, hopefully you enjoy it. I've had plenty of time with it and it's a cracker. We're at that point now, we're getting into that money, which is where Hegel amplifiers become a lot more obtainable. So it's a bit of a boiling pot, you know, it has to be good. So let's see how we get on. I've got this one still connected, so I'm trying to keep this one nice and warm. It's been on for a little while now, so I don't want to turn it off to unplug it all. And what we've got in comparison, we've got the same outputs as the 390, the same two analog inputs. We still have balanced inputs. I think we have that on the 120, and then we don't have it on the 95. The DAC, exactly the same. It doesn't have a BNC input or BNC output, digital output. It loses out on those two. I mean, I've never used them, so I'm, you know, if you're a fan of that, then this won't be the amplifier for you to use. So yeah, three optical inputs, computer, USB input, digital coaxial input, your network cable, and your power input. So pretty much exactly the same ins and outs as the 390 has. Same binding posts, so you can run your bananas at 90 degrees. If you want to see that now, I'll show you how I run them. Not here, because I have the space here, but at home. So I'll put my bananas in there. The diameter of that hole is the same as the diameter of this hole. And then I'll just wind on them anyway, just to make sure this isn't rattling. But that's how I run my banana plugs, and that saves you, I mean, it saves you about 25 to 30 mil on these, and these are a very receptive cable in terms of pushing them into a rack. This is the Cord XL, the Cord Epic. Let's spin it around, let's have a quick listen, and let's discuss how this one sounds. Let me just try something. So, the 190, got my trusty book, an impromptu speaker swap, which I'll explain later. This video isn't about those two speakers, it's about the amplifier. To test the amplifier fairly, I need to listen to it with the set of speakers that I've been listening to all the others with. There was a characteristic missing from this that can be put down to the amplifier because it's the same set of speakers. So, you know, you can only blame that. But I thought to myself, well, you know, we can't, it's kind of unfair to judge an amplifier by one set of speakers. We should be running multiple sets of speakers and, you know, putting it through
various different scenarios. For continuity throughout the test, I've kept the same speakers because I just want to listen to the amplifiers. And someone asked me a question, I think, on my last review on in the comments. It was an excellent question, or rather made a statement. They didn't really ask me a question. And it was that a lot of my explanation sounded like I was explaining a speaker rather than an amplifier. And that was a particularly good question, which made me think about what I was doing and made me sort of have a little look at a couple of other videos. And whilst maybe it's unfair to say that I'm explaining the speaker, because I'm not, and I know the speaker well, and I've explained various different sounds from various different pieces of kit with the same speakers, more so because of how well I know that speaker and the differences that pieces of kit will play through those speakers gives me a good reference. So, but I did question it, and I thought, you know, I was just listening to the 190 and I wasn't getting something that I wanted, something that I've had with the others, with those speakers before, and I wanted to see if I could pull it back with a different set of speakers, to see if we can create a different synergy, you know, a different environment, see if we can pull the amp out of its shell and get what we want, because the speaker or the amplifier or whichever shouldn't really matter. What should matter is the end sound and what we're happy with. You know, if we're unhappy but we've got all the best kit in the world, what are we doing, you know? So yeah, relatively unfair to the test, but fair to this amplifier, I put on a different set of speakers, which I'll explain as I go on. So characteristics wise, the 190 doesn't tread the path of the 390 and the 590. It is to say that those two have a relatively similar sound. You know, a lot of their sonic cues are the same, albeit a little bit more resolute with the 590, with a little bit more control. This one treads a different path. If you were to play this one to me and tell me it was a 390, it would be very obvious to me that it wasn't. So, you know, let's get into it. I'll read it out and I'll explain my findings. All right, so large bass, less bass resolution for the lesser concerned with absolute resolution. So this isn't an amp that you're gonna sit there and cut apart everything with. You know, it's not like the sort of scalpel accuracy that the 590 and the 390 have. This one kind of rounds things off in a happy way. It sounds a little bit more analog in its nature, a little bit richer, you know. But it does, you know, you can't have that characteristic without sacrificing some resolution or detail, because it is that lack of resolution and detail down the bottom that gives you that sort of rich, fluffy sort of bass sound, you know. So think warm white instead of cool white, and it's all, you know, it's a bit more warm white, this amp. Slightly recessed high frequency in comparison to the other two. It's all there, just slightly lower in output, more chill. And more chill is very important, because without that in that sentence, it sounds like quite a damning thing to say. You know, there's just less high frequency there. It's rolled off, it's turned down. And that's not the case. When I say there's less, you know, we're talking marginal. This amplifier is a fair bit calmer. It's going to pull less attention to its high frequency detail and sort of razor sharp sort of accuracy up top, and it just leans it off slightly, it just rolls it off slightly, which couples really well with my starting paragraph, is that it kind of lends itself to that sort of more analog-y sound than your sort of more clinical digital sound, you know. To give you a sort of gauge on it, if the 390 and the 590 were a 20 on the dial of high frequency, this is probably about 19. So we're not talking huge gaps. It's just obvious to me, knowing the other two, that it's just ever so slightly set back in terms of its high frequency. Yeah, warmer, more full-bodied characteristic. obvious difference in detail and resolution throughout, but very slight. So, you know, we're talking about an amplifier here that's a third of the cost of the 590 and just over half the cost of the 390. So we're going to see things like slightly less impact, slightly less resolution, when judging it only against amplifiers that are rightfully better than it. If we were to sit it in the £3,500 bracket, it's a very fast, clean, highly resolute amplifier, but we're not discussing it as a standalone piece of kit. We're discussing it where it sits in its line. So, you know, don't think that I'm saying bad stuff about it because it's no good. It's actually a great amplifier and, you know, deserves its price tag, in my opinion. You know, it's a cracking piece of kit. Again, I've put there very slight. Now, that's coming from me having, you know, back-to-back listened to from the top down. So, you know, we're talking, it's impossible to quantify, but not much. All right, not much difference in terms of the detail and resolution. And that's throughout, from the bass, through the mid-range, all the way up to the sort of higher frequencies, just ever so slightly less in terms of absolute detail and resolution compared to the other two. 3D sound stage slightly narrower, particularly less vertical staging. Now, the issue, if I was to take one up with this amplifier, for me, in this environment, using the same speakers as I have with the other test, if we were to say with the 590, now we're using the Special 40, so the 590 outclasses the Special 40, we determined that in the first test. The 390 worked quite well with that speaker. The Special 40 should be on a level with the 190 when we consider price points and the like. What happened in this scenario is my vertical soundstage closed out to, you know, imagine a more sort of letterbox kind of shape. You know, we still had all the width there, but top to bottom was quite narrow. You know, there was an obvious, you know, ceiling height to the soundstage. I couldn't quite explain it, you know, because of course I've listened to the other two with the same speakers and my vertical stage was there, it was fine. That's what prompted speaker swap, because I thought, well, okay, that may be a characteristic. It might be something to do with its power. You know, we know the Special 40 loves to dig deep. We know it likes a lot of power. Maybe it just isn't eking out what the other two were, you know? So I thought we'd wheel in a set of Amphion Argon 3Ss. I know that speaker, and whilst its bass performance for me isn't what the Special 40s is, it's in a slightly different price bracket, so can we fault it at that? I know that it throws up a much larger image. So top to bottom, width wise, that waveguide on the tweeter does an excellent job of throwing up an image that's much larger than, say, the equipment may be capable of. So it pulls a lot of that out of more shy, sort of recessed equipment. And so I'll put them in, and yeah, the vertical soundstage notably got better. There was less bass control down there, just because the Special 40 outperforms the 3Ss in that regard, and a little bit less of that sort of mid-range richness. You know, the Argon 3Ss are extremely good at their high frequency, and their high frequency size is very good. Like I say, this isn't a comparison review between the Special 40 and the Argon 3Ss, but there are reasons why I swapped out the Special 40 for that speaker, because characteristically it's going to pull out a couple of things that I wanted from the 190. Now, this asks more questions than it answers, really, because it now brings it right back to the listener, which is great. You know, if you are a low level, late night, more sort of chilled out listener, the 3S is probably the one, all right, because it will give you real nice detail, real nice size, and sort of accuracy, but in a pleasant way at lower volumes. If you're one to turn it up, let's say past the 65 point, you know, not we're not on about maxing it out. We're just on about maybe you want it to rock or jam a bit harder, then the Special 40 is going to be the one, you know? So that's kind of, like I say, it asked more questions than it answered, because whilst I did get vertical stage lift with the 3Ss, I kind of lost out a bit on the bottom end control. So, you know, it's a horses for courses kind of thing. And a good thing to do, you need to mix it up every now and again to realise what you like. Which one would I have? Is for a completely different video. So at some point in the future, I'm going to have to compare them to. They sit in similar price points. They're both fantastic, but they're both completely different. I don't think they share a single characteristic, which is just great, and it's good for that. You know, we're not all the same, are we? You know, I've got a sentence on the speaker swap, which will explain it, hopefully, in a very quick way, which I probably should have started about 10 minutes ago. More sparkle, glamour, less romance. Explain. When I swapped to the 3Ss, I got more of that sparkle, more of that glamour, more of that New York City street kind of mind-blowing scenery kind of scenario, but I had less romance. There was less connection for me in the sort of mid-range richness of it all, which is kind of where I kind of favor things, other than mid-bass on it. I'm a sucker for some mid-bass. But yeah, so that is neither good nor bad for either one of the speakers. Like I say, it's a tough one, that, because that depends completely on what you prefer to listen to. So yeah, I had more sparkle and glamour with the 3Ss, but I had more romance with the Special 40 in there in terms of where it sounded. I hope that makes sense and doesn't make me sound like a complete weirdo, but that's how I felt about them. Like I say, those two, we can put them in a different video. It's about the 190, this. And the 190 was feeding both of these speakers really well, you know, to decent volumes. We were just getting a different signature from both, you know. Now, that's not to say that the shallower sort of vertical staging is not a trait of the amplifier, because of course we had it with the 590, we had it with the 390, with the Special 40. So it is a part of the amplifier, but it just goes to show that we may need something a little bit more sensitive, something that's a little bit more bold, or a little bit more of a shimmery speaker that sometimes needs an amplifier matching with it to bring it down a peg or two. And that's, I think, where you might be with the 190. I'd like to hear this with, and I may do actually with my NS1000s, which, you know, we all know if you partner them incorrectly, they could be quite edgy, but partner them well and they're just phenomenal. So I may do that or I may just go on to the next one, because I'm enjoying going through them all, you know. So ideal partner for the Special 40 in terms of money and cost, although may well pair with less weighty, more forward sounding speakers. That's kind of what I've just covered now. So maybe something that, because the Dynaudio Special 40 can deliver bass 3 or 4 times the speaker size. It's notorious for it. So maybe if you have an amplifier that has a heavy bottom end, then something a little weightier with maybe a larger driver in a sealed box might be perfect. Or something a little bit more sensitive that's a little bit shy down the bottom but a little bit bold up the top would be the perfect match for this amplifier. I really like the way it sounds, and I also like the way it sounds different to the others. You know, if it was just the same thing but less of, I'd be bored by now, I'd be fed up. But this really surprised me, this one. There's a number of speakers that I would actually like to hear with it, whereas with the other two, I've been quite happy with the speaker. You know, the 590 was an obvious mismatch, but I couldn't go up because I wouldn't want to do that to the more entry products. I wouldn't want to keep, say, a Confidence 20 or a Heritage Special or something massive on there. So, yeah, I'm this one's been the first one that's made me think, you know, I'd like to hear those on there, or I'd like to hear that. So it's very obviously different to the other two, which is great, you know. That wraps up my review of the 190. I hope that you've understood most of it. I try not to get techie and also cliche. I try and just put it in the way that I experience it, which can come off awkward and weird. But it's just what I do. So yeah, that's the 190. We've done the 590, we've done the 390. We've got the 120 to do, and then we've got the 95. And I think at this point, I'm just gonna live a bit wild. I'm gonna throw whatever speaker I want in there, but I will always put the Special 40 on there just to give me a reference of what it may or may not be doing, because I find that it gives me a very good point to change a speaker, because I know that well, and I know the amp line well. When I'm not getting something from that pairing, it kind of gives me a good inkling as to what I should be using, and then that'll give me the best sort of scenario to explain to yourselves what I think that you should use with it. But at the end of the day, what I say might just sound a bit rubbish to you, so you'd have to try and experience it yourself. If you've got a local dealer, or if you're in the UK, if you're in the UK, we can sort you out. But if you're anywhere else in the world, find a decent dealer, give them the money for the amp, see if you can get some sort of home loan amplifier, and get amongst it, get some music on. Talking of music, I went to Pine Vinyl again yesterday, and got myself a pretty sweet bag of records. So I'll be playing these soon. Anyway, I'm just rambling on now, and any more of your time, and this video is going to be too long. All right? Just remember, guys, we are a shop. So if you're watching this and you are considering buying the product, come and buy it from us. If you aren't in the UK and you need some help, we can probably point you at someone in your own country. Yeah. Likes and subscribes and all that nonsense. That would be, all right, you take it easy, guys. I'm Carl, this is Studio In Car. Everything you need to get hold of me or us is down below, all right? Take it easy.